Hello and welcome to Big Picture. I am Vishal Dahiya, and today we will look at the entire issue of data mischief and the social media platforms like Facebook, which have been in news of late. Social media giant Facebook is facing severe criticism over the major leak of user data to political consultants associated with the 2016 Trump campaign in the United States presidential election. The Cambridge Analytica data breach, in which information from Facebook account of millions of people in the United States was used to build their psychological profile, has once again raised questions over Facebook's ability to protect the privacy of its users. India has approximately 250 million active users on Facebook, and several political parties and their leaders are also using Facebook and other several social media platforms to reach out to people. The recent controversy surrounding Facebook has generated a debate in our country on the issue of data privacy and whether the present legal mechanism in place is enough to tackle problems similar to what has happened in the United States and other countries. Also, what might be the effect of deriving data from social media platforms to analyze election trends and wooing voters based on analysis done through that data? For more on this, we are joined by a distinguished panel of guests in the studio today. Let me start by introducing them to you, starting with Mr. S.Y. Qureshi, former Chief Election Commissioner. We also have with us a journalist friend, somebody who has been working on digital media platforms, Mr. Venkat Anand from the Kent. We also have with us cyber law expert, Advocate Karnika Seth. And we are also joined by the Chairman and Managing Director of Access India Limited, Pradeep Gupta. Welcome, all of you, to Rajya Sabha Television Studios. Let me begin with you, Anand, since you've been writing on the digital media platforms. And we would start by understanding the context of the problem which we are discussing right now. As in, there has been an issue of data breach by Cambridge Analytica, something which has made news world over. One, where are we placed right now as far as India is concerned and the entire issue of social media, the data privacy, the data breach, and the checks and balances by the social media platforms are concerned?
Okay, I think we need to start off by by looking at the current situation globally. I mean, in the case of the European Union, which is now going to come up with its GDPR in April. Similarly, the US obviously has as you can see, the Congress is now trying to be more proactive as far as pulling up these social media giants like Facebook and Google. Mm-hmm. India obviously has been far off the conversation as far as this is concerned, even though we do have a consultation process that is ongoing for our own data protection bill, which is coming up. The consultations are happening mm-hmm. right now for a committee headed by Justice Sri Krishna. I think it is an opportune time to have these conversations in India about privacy and data protection. I think this was the perfect opportunity to sort of do that. Mm-hmm. But we obviously have gone the Cambridge Analytica way. They are allegedly contracted by the Congress, BJP. It's completely taken the focus off the global issues, which should have been, in fact, in my view, what we should have been speaking about.
Okay. Putting apart the political controversy on this, let me bring in Mr. Qureshi. Mr. Qureshi, the entire election process is what everybody is talking about as far as the Cambridge Analytica case is concerned. And when we talk about the Indian situation, as Anant also put out, that the concern rather should be to address all these issues vis-a-vis the data privacy, the breach of data, the use of data by third parties. So, as a former head of the Election Commission, what is your viewpoint on the fact that to what extent is the reach of these social media platforms here in our system right now that we can, be a little rest assured, or should we be worried as of now?
There are two dimensions. One is our data, whether anybody has access to that, and it can be manipulated, it can be corrupted. That is one where mm-hmm. we can be absolutely sure. We are not linked up with Facebook. We are not linked up even with Aadhaar. So therefore, there is no question. The other, of course, is social media through which they try to approach and influence the voters. which is possible even without access to election commission data, because the citizens of India are all there. Mm-hmm. And most of them are on Facebook, and Facebook data analysis, which is being done by all the marketing companies, is a normal routine activity. They know who are the young people, and mostly they are young people, who are the urban, rural people, and designing your communication program specifically for them is rather easy. Mm-hmm. Election Commission has used Facebook only to propagate its voter education activities. Only for promotion and education, did not give any access to the data.
Something which isn't clarified by the Election Commission.
Which has been clarified, which is the most important thing. Even Aadhaar is not yet linked up at all. And even when we were to link up with Aadhaar, as it was started in 2015 and stopped midway when the Supreme Court questioned it, the only limited purpose was the deduplication of voters. Mm-hmm. Through the Aadhaar, we'll find out whether Anant is registered at 2-3 places, so that we can identify the duplicate and remove. And that's all. There is no influence of voting. The most crucial thing could have been whether through hacking or through access to the data, you can influence the voting decision of a voter. Okay. That is absolutely safe.
So the data which Election Commission has, or the data which Election Commission relies on, is something which is not in danger as of now. But when it comes to the social profiling issue, let me bring in Mr. Pradeep Gupta from Access India Limited, somebody whose company has been involved with this entire process of analyzing data or analyzing election trends and all that. Mr. Gupta, to what extent are Indian companies or Indian analysts, political analysts or election analysts, are depending upon the data which is available on the social media websites?
Okay, Vishal, let me tell you, when you say data, there are two types of data. The data, one is the real-time data, when you go and check the electorate's moods and their needs and their preferences. That's one, which is the real-time data. Mm-hmm. Particularly in India, we largely depend on the real-time data, because here the dynamics are different than the developed country. Here political dynamics and social dynamics are being changed very frequently. So that's one part. As far as coming to the, how far we are dependent on the social media, let me tell you first the social media penetration. Even if you take Facebook, for instance, which is 20 crore users in India, which means 15% user. And when we say 20 crore and 15% in total country, it is largely in the urban sector. Mm-hmm. And our demography is such, the large number of voters, up to more than 70%, comes from the rural strata. So the impact would be very negligible at this point of time.
But Mr. Gupta, it is said that it is the fence sitters who decide an election, and the number might be something which might be contested. You're saying 15%, that is 20 crore. There are some figures which say 25 crore users on Facebook and around 29% on WhatsApp, around 12% on Twitter. Those are different figures. But harvesting that particular data, which is on social media websites, something for which Facebook is under question right now, it's facing severe criticism for letting third-party apps have that particular data. What is the status here? Are our poll analysts and election analysts dependent on that data?
They are dependent, but the kind of extent which the dependency is, I would say not more than 20%.
Okay. So that's not more than 20%. Let's bring in the legal angle of this entire aspect. And as has been pointed out earlier as well, we have with us Advocate Karnika Seth and cyber law expert. Ms. Seth, the question here is, with the facts very well in place as to how large the number of social media users in India are, and we know, as Mr. Gupta was pointing out, that at least 20% of the figures they have or which they use are derived from the social media platforms, do we have enough legal mechanisms to go ahead and check illegal or wrong use of data which is available on social media platforms?
Well, as far as the general consumer population or the the users are concerned, there is very little awareness on, you know, what are the terms and conditions that they are agreeing and signing a click wrap agreement by, say, clicking on the I agree button. Very few people really bother to read the terms and conditions, and in the fine print there is, you know, one clause which will say, okay, this is the information which we are collecting, this is how it's going to be processed, and this is how it will be disclosed or transferred to a third party. This needs to be done in a very explicit manner, especially if there are lengthy, you know, rules and regulations given there and terms and conditions. So to be fair to a citizen or to be fair to a user, this needs to be explicitly taken in the form of an informed consent of a user. Now, as far as the law is concerned, the corporation's actually liable and they're bound to have ISO 27001 certification or recommended certifications to ensure the data which they're collecting, like personal sensitive data of users which they collect, is kept in a secure manner. And under law, IT Act, there are provisions, clear provisions, civil as well as criminal liability provisions, to ensure that, you know, they don't release any kind of data unauthorizedly, they don't collect any kind of data unauthorizedly. And there are up to 3 years of imprisonment for those kind of breaches where they have not taken a consent from a user and given away or transferred the data to somebody else for a commercial reason. So that's something which I'd like to bring forth. However, there is a point which we need to really ensure that, you know, when in our system, the legal framework, the way it works, an individual may not even come to know that his data has been breached. And even if he comes to know, it's difficult for him. The onus is on him to prove that there is, you know, there has been a wrongful loss caused to him. And generally, this wrongful loss is taken in terms of monetary value. And that's where the problem is when if he wants to claim compensation for it, under Section 43A of the IT Act becomes the challenge. Further, then, when it comes to prosecution, again, the onus is on him. He's saying that so-and-so is liable or so-and-so is guilty. How to prove that? So these are some practical challenges, and our law needs to be more proactive in terms of, you know, giving a security to a common man that his data will be kept securely, explicit permissions will be taken from him, explicit disclosures will be made of what use is this data going to be made into, and he has to, with informed consent, download an app. He would then be able to give a consent freely and voluntarily and with full information.
Okay.
That's something which our legal framework needs to look at, and I'm hopeful that this new data protection law which we are getting in the country, Justice Sri Krishna Committee is looking into it, needs to look at it from that angle as well.
Okay, so what Kanika is saying here is that, you know, we have a mechanism in place, but it might not be strong enough to go ahead and tackle the challenges, the kind of one which have been thrown by the recent controversy. Anant, what needs to be understood here is that there are certain ways and means in which the data is being used from the social media platforms, sometimes by the social media giants themselves, sometimes by the third parties. What exactly is the importance of that particular data is pretty much clear. But how it can be used in a positive or a negative way is something which the users also need to understand.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, the US elections of 2016 were a clear sort of indicator as to how this data could be used. I mean, as you rightly pointed out, I think the undecideds, you know, were the obvious, you know, swing voters, as we call it, of the obvious targets of this particular targeting campaign, and that constituted close to a 40% of the vote there. So obviously, it as even those in CA in Cambridge Analytica, and obviously those in the Trump campaign who officially have denied their involvement in the scandal, but. If you see what the Cambridge Analytica guys have said, it was just about giving these swing voters something to think, to basically to consider and to think about. May not necessarily translate into vote, but an attempt is being made to influence him to vote for a certain candidate, which in this case happened to be Trump. So obviously, you know, there is a use here, I mean, to influence a voter. Or anybody, I mean, or any product for that matter. I mean, advertisers are using it to sell products to you or to sell a service to you. But in this case, especially, you know, since elections are, and I call political parties the, you know, the biggest client for these, I mean, companies. So since elections are going to be their big focus, obviously there is going to be an attempt by political parties to, you know, to sort of influence a audience on these platforms, just before elections. So it is, so as we've seen, you know, these the data sets can be put to use, in a negative.
Okay, that brings us to the question and to Mr. Qureshi again. Mr. Qureshi, as Anant is pointing out, the data can be used to influence voters in a specific way, something which we have seen in the Cambridge Analytica case. Is our electoral system robust enough, and does Election Commission has enough powers within its ambit to go ahead and tackle such challenges? Because as far as legal framework is concerned, Karnika has pointed out that yes, we have a framework, but that needs to be more upgraded more. What about the election system?
You know, again, there are two dimensions to your question. One is what kind of data we have. We have two types of data. One is the electoral roll, which has you are the voter, your father, your house number, mm-hmm. your age, and your family details, because they're normally all together. So second set of data is the election results. Now, you will notice that the EVM, there is a lot of debate on EVM. EVM is designed to be a standalone machine deliberately. It is not networked. And even the totals from the machine are actually manually tabulated. Mm-hmm. So that there is no scope for any manipulation. Therefore, that bit, the most sensitive thing here is the voting. That mm-hmm. should not be subject to any manipulation from outside. Second aspect is social media and its use and abuse outside. Mm-hmm. For us, social media is like any other media. Now, the law which applies to media, any other media, applies here also. And what it applies here? Two things. One, how much money you spend on any media, you have to report to the Election Commission. Secondly, the content has to be regulated. You cannot indulge in hate speech. You cannot indulge in personal attack and all that. That is monitored by the Election Commission. And those laws are applicable in this case as well.
Okay.
Of course, one question used to be, how will you catch?
Yes.
That used to be a big question.
Yes, that's what I was coming to.
My answer is that difficulty to catch cannot be a question. It is difficult to catch even a rapist and a murderer. That doesn't mean you ignore it or you make it legal. You have to catch, you have to make an effort. The same US companies, which mm-hmm. were very possessive about their data, are now falling in line. Okay. They're sharing the data, they're building security mechanisms.
Okay, we'll come back to you, Anant. Let me bring Mr. Gupta here. Mr. Gupta, as Anant is also pointing out, and all of us can also understand it very clearly, that the relationship between companies like yours, which analyze political data or the social data to arrive at some conclusion in terms of its electoral or political value, and the political parties, is a mutually beneficial one. But the question which arises is that during, in the course of this mutually beneficial relationship, is there a chance or is there a danger which is being posed to the users who have shared their data of this being utilized in a particular manner?
That's what Rahul, I mentioned earlier. See, let's take a specific example of our company. Our company is totally, and I would say to the extent of 100%, not even 99%, depend on real-time data, mm-hmm. which we do collect by surveying the people. And when we survey the people, we do collect their issues, problem, preferences, etc., etc. And there is no question of we parting data with anybody else. What we do is their preference and choices and issues they are facing, and we try and put forward those issues and problems to the right stakeholder. And if these right stakeholders are the policy makers or the politicians, or be it the corporate decision makers, they are likely to address their problems and issues and preferences. And if they do so, they are likely to win their hearts. It is as simple as that. Now, coming to these data, uh-huh. which is the stored data, or stolen, or purchased from ABCD company like Facebook or anybody else, there they try to understand the psychology of a particular segment or a particular demography, and they try to create campaign out of it. When you create the campaign out of it, generally the campaigns are designed based on the target audience needs. And in the campaign, you try and address those needs, mm-hmm. So it is as simple as that. And when it comes to the dissemination of these campaign, okay. Then you use various media, including social media.
Okay, so you're saying that that particular data, which is harvested, mined, or looked at, or analyzed by companies like yours, is something which is not put to a negative use in any way. Let me bring Kanika again on this. Kanika, you're pointing out earlier in your first response the way users have to click on social media websites, agreeing to the terms of agreement, and most of us do not understand the implications or the meaning of that particular agreement which we are entering into. So one question which arises here is, do these social media platforms have enough checks and balances within their own system to ensure that the data which is shared with these platforms by the users is not put to any negative use?
Correct. I think this is very a pertinent question in today's controversy, what we're discussing. There is a ISO standard, which is 27001, which is recommended standard for ensuring that every corporation who collects personal sensitive information of a user maintains reasonable security practices. We also have reasonable security practices rules in the country where it defines what kind of data is sensitive data, for example, financial information or any kind of biological information, medical information of a user. And there are other, also factors which are put in there. And one has to ensure that that standard has been complied fully with. And privacy, the terms of use have to be very clearly laid out on their websites in a very explicit manner. Now, having said that, what happens is if a user doesn't read it, he's still bound by the law. But it could be, presumption in law will be to his advantage if he is able to show that it was not put in a very explicit manner, or if he says that it was put in a very ambiguous manner and he did not have any idea that such data could be transferred or sold to a third entity, which would even be of a personal sensitive nature. Mm-hmm. Now, that's something which he can definitely question.
Okay.
The Election Commission needs to step in at this point immediately with an advisory. Which ensures what it defines and selects out what is unfair trade practice, something like unfair trade practice, unfair electioning, or unfair.
So there are several steps which will have to be taken
at this present juncture.
By all the stakeholders, Kanika. Thank you very much there. Anant, before we bring this discussion to an end, you're coming up with a suggestion in between. All these steps will have to be taken. That's fine. But when it comes to the implementation of all these points one by one, can we be rest assured that we are, once again, the same question which I started with, can we be rest assured that we are safely placed as of now as far as the entire this data game is concerned?
Well, I wouldn't be so sure. I mean, I'm extremely skeptical about this. But at the same time, I think in terms of steps that we need to take, first and foremost, the Election Commission needs to get very proactive about these things. Because obviously, since 2013, sir, when if you could correct me, when they had a guideline, social media or Facebook has changed. It's now a 2 billion user product or a company.
Okay.
And similarly, Indian electioneering has changed. I mean, half of your content on these platforms are political content.
Okay.
And some of them which are bordering on hate speech trolling is commonplace. So obviously, the Election Commission needs to sort of, come up, straight away, with an advisory.
With a mechanism to deal
Absolutely.
With all these issues.
And also to monitor, election posts on these platforms or during elections. I mean, it is very easy to say we have a law.
Okay, so clearly it looks like that as far as the entire issue of data privacy, data breach, or the way we were calling it, the data mischief on the social media platforms is concerned, there are several issues involved here. Not only the user, that is us, will have to be more informed and sensitive about what we are trying to do on the social media platforms to the extent to which we are going to share our data, but the legal framework as well as the other allied framework will have to be made more robust to ensure that all such cases or all such issues are dealt with in a proper manner. We'll come back again on Monday with a different topic and different set of guests. Till then, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.